So what do you enjoy about doing animation?
He had so many of my favorite movies.
It's, well, in general, it's just the easiest job in the world. You get to go in and have fun. You don't have to do any of the hard work. You just go for the absolute fun part, and that's it. It's just it's so easy. You know, I said on the panel, you don't have to... you know, you can roll out of bed, race in, do your thing, and then go back, you know, get more sleep.
Well, it's easy if you're talented and nail it. You know, there's the things where, like, oh, okay, let's try it, you know, like a little more higher. You know, there's plenty of nightmare scenarios where, but, you know, you nail it so it becomes easy.
But with this show,
I hate sincerity, but it's true.
This show specifically, it just it's so different, and the jokes are nuts. They're so unique and absurd, and I mean the premise starts out absurd, so it's right up my alley. This is a show that I would watch if I wasn't a part of it. So to get to be a part of it. It was a no-brainer when I read the script.
What you're saying, even like just dumb scenarios, the understanding of an actor helps so much. Where it's not like even this episode, we're like, so now you get poo in your mouth, but you're tortured because you like it, and invariably it's like okay, instead of like what? You know, it's like. He gets it, so it just becomes an easier process.
So when you met with them or they offered you the part, what did they have to show you in the beginning?
I don't even care.
Yeah.
Well, I have had the same agent for 22 years. It's a guy I went to college with, and he...
Oh, that's usually a big mistake.
But it was. I think I remember... I don't remember the timeline, but it was, I was just, I remembered it was like, because I've gotten a chance to be on a part of a bunch of different animated shows, and it was like, I can't do anymore, I gotta spend my time doing this, and we really wanted to write MacGruber 2, and then Matt said, Matt Rice, the agent I'm talking about, said, I trust him so much because we have the same sense of humor. He said, no, you trust me. You got to read this show. So I read it. It was like instant. And I had met Scott before, so that was another thing that made me think, like, oh, I got to check it out. It's such a funny show.
I was drawn to, like,
I would have been jealous if we got to do it.
Yeah, good.
Tell us about your character.
My character is called Rad Cunningham, and I'm basically just the whiny, I guess I'm the Rob Lowe's mortal enemy.
Yeah, nemesis, but actually as you've developed, you really become like a... kind of like in ways the main character to me, because Rob is very like his character is narcissistic and cool, but like certain glass ceiling to certain things. But we find out like Rad, oh, what a, you know, he's just like a shitty guy who lies about being rich. But then we have like, oh, his parents took him out of a dumpster and they sold him to a Canadian's kid show where the guy probably did bad things to him. And then like, oh, actually he was stolen, he should have been rich. So we're finding all these nuances with your character. We're like, I feel really bad for that guy. He's twisted, but for all these reasons. So as the season goes on, there's like so much weird depth where you look at like, oh, Rad, he can't help it, but oh, then he, you know, he fucks up again. Like once the Chrysalis gives him sympathy, then he like tries to kiss her. Ruin the moment. I don't get it. So it's like really like a fun. He's to me the funnest character. Just like,
who do you channel for that? To kind of give life to that character. Do you channel a particular...
just kind of my own whiny self. They make it very easy because they write it so well. And so, like it's the scripts do so much of the work for you. So it's a lot of times I go in and I I think we all kind of share very similar senses of humor, so you have a feeling you know what they're going for, and if you don't, they're in the, you know, they're in the booth on the other side of the glass, and they'll tell you exactly what they want.
Right. I noticed telling him earlier, like, it becomes easier when just even his inflection has changed the writing of the character, where it's kind of like,
he's a little more shitty.
Because you go to skip two or three, and then you hear the voice, and then you can write for the voice, like, not only the figurative voice, but also the actual tone and everything. It becomes easier. Then we imitate it, and then it just becomes a more efficient thing, and then you find out and more like, oh, this is, you know, like you told like a sad sack prom story once, so then we're like, oh, let's multiply that times 1,000 in terms of shittiness, you know. So it's like all these elements of like just come together and it becomes efficient.
Is the show going to be serialized in season-long arcs, or is it sort of a standalone episode format?
I'll try to do both. I'm trying not to rely on, that's always a thing, like season-long arc. We have a finale, but nothing is too, like, you know, I don't know what's going on kind of vibe, so I don't want to say serialized might be too much of a
somewhere over. In between.
Yeah, it's definitely in between. I wouldn't call it serialized because you can see each one, and it has, you know, you have some artistic license for these ending things that are like just wrapped up or dumb things happen. You have a little reset button, you know, which is in like in cartoons, but there, you know, there is some arcs too within it.
What's one TV show that you can't miss aside from your own shows, and one show that
everybody wants to bring their
I can't stand it. I don't watch a lot of TV shows, but one that I never miss is The Bachelorette.
The Bachelor.
Who's your favorite guy this year?
Who's my favorite guy? I have not watched the most recent one, all of it, so I don't know if this guy's still on there. I kind of like, what's his name, Ben? The Ben that's still there. I liked the Ben that got kicked off, too, but the Ben that's still there, and the guy Jared I really like. I think those are my two favorites.
Good choices.
Yeah.
Strong kids and men.
I know a hardcore biker in Detroit who just memes out Bachelors. It's just like, it's the only show he watches.
I have the weirdest collection of shows that I watch. It's all SportsCenter highlights, which I guess Forensics Files. Now I can't stop watching those. That's how I go to bed, and I think that explains why I'm not sleeping very well. Recently, waking up when I hear anything, it's like somebody is definitely in the house with a knife.
Yeah, remember to get their skin under my fingernails so my dead body can solve my murder.
But so many shows there's so much good TV. I've never watched, that's not true, I've watched two slivers of Game of Thrones, and they were the two biggest spoilers. It was the Red Wedding thing, and then some guy getting his eyes poked down his head.
Yeah.
And I just happened to watch both those things. So I'm really excited to get into Game of Thrones, Better Call Saul. It's all family, so it's I've gotten to meet most of the people there.
I hate to watch my family on TV.
You're right. it's just a really supportive group. I think pretty much every, well, I guess I can't speak everybody, but like, you know, the SNL family seems to usually keep up to date on what's going on in the show, and it was so fun being a part of that SNL 40th and getting to meet all these people. You know, a lot of them I had gotten to meet during my time there. They would stop by from time to time, but like Dana Carvey I had never met. That was a thrill. Just a ton of people. It was really fun.
Well, I have one last man question for you. When Phil and Carol move away, has Phil learned anything from this first go-around, or is he just going to be the same type of guy in the new society?
I think that Phil has learned his lesson. That's the that's the, they're still going to be at each other's throats from time to time, but it's a more caring version of that. Because Carol's still Carol, and Phil is still Phil, or excuse me, Tandy. No, Phil is still Tandy.
But you don't know right now.
We've written about six outlines, and we're still working through it. We have a lot of areas, a lot of points we know we're going to hit, but you know, these are all, you know, trying to do the same tone, but just find ways to switch it up a little bit and keep people guessing.
You could influence that. Do you like what he's saying?
Speaking of laughing, man.
He definitely has grown from the experience of this season.
But he could turn on a dime, right?
Yeah, you never know. You never know with him.
Bob was mentioning how he has some sort of apocalypse show coming up soon, too. And I mean, will he be another man showing up in your show, or will you be showing up on him?
Will Rob?
Phil would not like.
I don't think so, because, I mean, he's got his own show. He's got the Grinder coming out. Mm-hmm. So, unless there's some kind of cross-pollination, nothing in the works. Or is there? Who knows? I don't think so.
What's the best movie you've seen recently, and have you ever walked out of a movie?
I have walked out of a movie. I'm not going to say which one. I don't want to get in trouble.
But it's a new
one. I've walked out of two movies, and they were both movies that people probably thought would consider.
Because you were angry and thought the movie was
kind of the base that you're starting.
One of them, I thought,
you
got to
be pretty loud and pretty energetic. That's the base.
Did not. One was overhyped, and I was and was very similar to this director's last thing.
Then you got to run and jump and do action and have sex. And then
you can't tell me this is cool. I get to decide that for myself, and I'm not buying this.
Wow.
But and then the other one was, what's that?
Just, like, I hate a lot of stuff, but I sit through it.
Like, I very rarely walk out of things. Oh, then what was that? And then the other one was
a
musical. That I just didn't. It was bugging me because I thought the humor in the musical was just not funny. It's like getting all these laughs. And I'm like, no! I don't know why. It was upsetting to me, and I was like, I gotta get out of this theater because I'm something's happening to me that I don't like. Yeah, it's crazy. They're both are. I bet if I watch them again, or if I watch them on a DVD or something, I probably would like it. It was just.
Do you have psychological things about controlling society or something? Maybe
yeah,
that's it.
I do. It's like, you know. Wait, what do you?
The best movie you've seen recently?
God, I was working so hard for the last year on the show that I basically didn't see anything. So I did a teeny bit of catch up. I haven't seen anything in a theater recently, but I did see the Whiplash. Oh, right, that's the movie I loved. That was kind of my favorite of the ones I've recently seen.
You mentioned MacGruber too. Has Moonbeam City delayed you even more in getting to work on that?
No, it's so easy to work on the show. It's such a minor time commitment. I feel kind of guilty being up on the stage with these guys because they work so hard, and I, you know, we get to go in there and share in the glory, which we don't.
We
work as hard as we can during the tiny sliver of time that we're there, but these guys do all the intense work. So, I can't. It's my own. It's basically the last quarter that's made it. And Norma's been working really hard on the Lonely Island movie, and so at some point we'll get the opposite of the perfect storm.
The
perfect storm, but in the calm version of that. We'll all have a little bit of time. We definitely plan on doing it at some point.
When are you going to stop running?
No, it's it's a very good problem to have, to not have the time to. Sure. To work on that,
but not to have the time to reflect on what
I just trust the guys.
The problem is,
yeah.
Yes. Are you hoping for a role in the Han Solo movie?
Oh man, that would be really wonderful. I would love that.
Yeah. I saw that William Shatner, the Captain Kirk Starshine, shining the boots of Han Solo, and it pissed me off. I tweeted that. Captain Kirk shining Han Solo. And Han Solo was all like that. And Captain Kirk. It fucking made me mad.
What's the last album you downloaded and what you like about it?
Last album I downloaded.
I had not somehow skimmed it. I was
I think it was a Kinks album. I'm way behind with new music.
40 years.
I was always a Kinks fan. For some reason, when I go into writing mode, I'll really like get compulsive on some kind of album and just listen to it throughout the writing process. Just the same one album over and over and over again. And I've had Village Green Preservation Society going for like a year, and then I started venturing out because I thought I never want this to get to the point that I'm sick of it, and I don't think I ever would, but I just have to start downloading a couple more of their albums.
It's more that society control issue. A year is a long time.
Yeah. I do that with different days. I did that with different scripts have different soundtracks. Like Deer Hoof was one. And then there was, during The Last Man on Earth, I was listening to Band of Horses a lot.
No,
I don't know if this is a fascinating.
It is.
It is a lot of, I do get stuck on like that. Like, I could eat the same meal every day. I'm just, I wear basically the same clothes every day. I'm just kind of a creature of habit, I guess.